Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see, those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity. One of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way, but the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A dish that is broken.
my spirit, but my trust is in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. In your hands is my destiny. Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your kindness. Take courage and be stout-hearted, all you who hope in the Lord. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing that everything was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said,
"I have not lost any of those you gave me."
Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup of the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was with the gatekeeper said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold, and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there, keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret, I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of the Jews, son." "I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said, Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man? If he were not a criminal, would he have not have handed him over to you? Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute anyone."
This fulfilled the word of Jesus, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?
I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
Then you are a king.
You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at the Passover. Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said, and they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And Pilate said to them,
behold the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
crucify him, crucify him.
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and I have the power to crucify you?
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was a preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
behold your king.
Take him away. Crucify him.
Shall I crucify your king?
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read,
Jesus, the Nazarene, the King of the Jews.
Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
what I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top down. So they said to one another,
let's not tear it.
This fulfilled the passage in Scripture that says,
"They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots."
This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the foot, the cross of Jesus, where his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it on to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over his spirit. Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled:
"Not a bone of it will be broken."
And again, another passage says,
"They will look upon him whom they have pierced."
After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus. And Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths, along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden was a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Yes.
This sequence, the Triduum sequence, is full of mystery. Last night we heard a beautiful homily from Father Paul about the mystery of the Eucharist, Jesus' body and blood, and at the same time taking on the look of bread and wine. You see, in a mystery, there is paradox, something seemingly contradictory. And yet, we know that it is true by our faith. Tonight, we explore the mystery of the cross and Jesus' passion. One of the things to take into account as we look at mystery is that it is something that cannot be fully understood or explained. We live in a world full of scientism, among other heresies, that wants to look for meaning in science, in facts, in figures, in exploring the substance of a thing. And yet, for a human being, we do not find meaning or purpose in those. A fact is just a fact until you interpret it and apply it. Science is helpful in establishing facts. Philosophy and theology help us to make sense of them. Mixed in with all that is going on these days is the mystery of the Trinity, the most notable mystery and paradox in our faith. Three persons, one God. Not three gods, one God in three persons. In this mystery, we experienced a few months back our Christmas time, where the incarnation, the hypostasis was pulled together, often known as the hypostatic union. Here, Jesus assumed human nature on top of his divine person, the Word, the second person of the Trinity, etc. That one divine person assumed also, on top of his divine nature, a human nature. And that changes everything. That makes Jesus walk, allows Jesus to walk with us, still God, and experience as we experience things, feelings, pain, suffering, joy. The Athanasian Creed, the one that's least often referenced, often we hear about the Apostles' Creed, maybe we pray it when we do our rosaries, and the Nicene Creed, we normally hear at Mass. But there is a third creed that is part of our faith. It's very long, and it's mostly about the nature of the Trinity. It's where we find various explanations. But there's a couple of things in there that are worth noting. In it, it says, "We believe and confess that our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is God and man, God of the substance of the Father, begotten before the world, and man of the substance of his mother, born in the world, perfect God and perfect man, who although he is God and man, he is not two, but one Christ. One, not by conversion of the Godhead into flesh, but by taking of the manhood into God. One altogether, not by confusion of substance, but by unity of person." The one person, Jesus, Word, second person of the Trinity. So God and man is one Christ, who suffered for our salvation, as we talk about today, descended into hell, something we will reflect on tomorrow, rose again the third day from the dead, ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, God Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. Did you note that sentence in there? Jesus assumes human nature to raise us up into God, not the other way around. He walks the earth, but by his incarnation, he lifts us up. And that brings us to the mystery of the cross. The cross has many paradoxes associated with it as well. Last night, we heard about transubstantiation, the Eucharist. Today, we understand the cross as both a gruesome place and the greatest expression of Jesus' love ever. The cross as an ugly physical reality, and yet at the same time, our doorway to heaven. For it is through our unification with Christ on the cross that we do pass through. I don't know about you, but through my life, I've had a series of fundamental graces. Any? A handful. Those fundamental graces happened at various times. One was in a confession. One was in adoration in the middle of the night, right before I entered diaconate formation. And as I was prostrate before the Blessed Sacrament in the middle of the night, I suddenly experienced, for me, this doesn't mean that it's applicable to everyone, it was a gift for me in my journey of being at the foot of the cross, at least feeling that I was, and experiencing that tremendous love. Love so profound and so overwhelming from the cross that it was scary. It was just so much. So much more than I could imagine. Fast forward a few years, right after I had finished my during my 1 week long silent retreat to become a deacon, something that's required by canon law. And in the middle of that week, as I was praying silently, this time in my little cell that we had for the retreat center, I was again experienced the idea that I was with Jesus, and this time on the cross, and this time experiencing his very substance being stretched and even torn, his separation in his humanness from the Father, and how painful that reality was for him, beyond the pain, the physical pain of the cross. Now, he wasn't separated from God, of course, but in his humanness, in the descent to hell, in the time on the cross, those feelings came forth. At least that is what I experienced. St. Ignatius talks about these kinds of experiences, and hopefully each of you has had more than a few in your life. They are foundational. They help us walk our journey as we go. Those foundational graces have a name. They're called consolation, a gift from God of grace, without a prior cause. Comes from Rule 2 of the second week in the discernment of spirits in the spiritual exercises. I know many have experienced that. If you've not, I would highly recommend it. And those graces carry us forward. Mine happened to have been the two most fundamental ones related to exactly what we are working with today. Yours might be something completely different. In fact, when I arrived at Creighton University just a few weeks after that second experience, I didn't believe it. I knew it was real, and I knew it had changed me. But I was like, can you even hang on the cross with Jesus? 3 weeks into a class, actually 4 weeks, almost at the very end, one of my professors went through the spiritual exercises, and as she did, I could place each and everything she was talking about in a sequence in my life. And she got to this piece and said what she said, and then she said, at this point, some people experience this at the foot of the cross, but some also experience it on the cross. Thank you, Lord, I'm not totally crazy, right? As we walk forward through this, this event here and through these next days, it seems to me that we can take a look at the journey Jesus is walking with us, our experiential Jesus, the Jesus who became, who took on human nature so that he could walk with us, so that he could experience everything we experience, and even worse or better, so that we're never alone. It might be worth taking a look at the cross and saying, particularly this next day, and saying, Jesus on the cross, are you speaking to me now? Is there a message for me this year in this Lent? Might be worth taking to writing the things you have experienced this Lent. Is there something there that's calling you further and greater? And then sometime after Lent, maybe during the Easter season, take a look at those graces that have brought you here. Because Jesus is walking with you in a way that is to be known to you. So that when you step forward in the grace that's offered, he is holding you up.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty and ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout the world, may persevere with steadfast faith, confessing your name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church, to govern the holy people of God. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, may their maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for Bishop Peter, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace they may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the hearts of their inmost heart, ears of their inmost hearts, and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who made your Church ever faithful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased, as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one Church. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty everlasting God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom in one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and unity in the bond of charity through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of the name and in faithfulness to his covenant. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who bestow your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your Church, that the people you first made your own may attain fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, grant that those who do not confess Christ, that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mysteries of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right with sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God Himself. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always, by desiring you and by finding you, come to rest. Grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you the one true God, the and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will, for the true peace and freedom of all. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of your people, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that He may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, grant to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because in their hour of need your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for the people in Ukraine and in all war zones of the world, for those who have fled the dread of violence and have been deprived of their homes. For all women and men who stand up with their lives to ward off evil and to protect the weak and the persecuted, let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, you have compassion for the lowly and the poor, but you cast down oppressors as you guide Israel out of slavery of Egypt. So in our days, save all victims of war and violence. Change the hearts of evildoers and let peace be victorious through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
God bless us all.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
God let us adore.
Thank you.
single grain and not give life. God was slain. By his wounds I am set free. By his blood I've been redeemed. The great divine he crossed for me. Oh, praise the God of Calvary.
Your blood ran down.
blood ran down. Your blood ran down. From your head down your face, from your hands to your feet, your blood ran down for me. From your head down your face, from your hands to your feet, your blood ran down. Your blood ran down. Your blood ran down for me. Your blood ran down. Your blood ran down. Your blood ran down. Your blood ran down. From your head down your face, from your hands to your feet, your blood ran down for me. From your head down your face, from your hands to your feet, your blood ran down. Your blood ran down. Your blood ran down for me.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord.
Regina Celi,
Let our Alleluia,
qui aquem
meruis deportare,